Okay, we are looking at a left scapula, and the scapula is colloquially referred to as the shoulder blade. And I always tell students whenever they're trying to locate or visualize where their scapula is, I always say, give yourself a pat on the back. And you can feel this posterior portion of the scapula, this large ridge right here, which is referred to as the spine of the scapula. And it serves to kind of divide the scapula in terms of where muscles attach. So really what you're talking about with the scapula are rotator cuff muscles. Rotator cuff muscles are surrounding both the posterior portion and the anterior portion. So you'll have your supraspinatus muscle sitting right here, attached to the bone. Infraspinatus, that makes sense, so under the spine. And then teres minor is going to be right underneath here. Now, the spine is extending posteriorly, and then as you get more lateral, you have what's referred to as the acromion. And sometimes you hear it as referred to as the acromion process. And I want you to palpate, because palpation is really important in terms of really giving yourself an understanding of where these bones are located. So as you put your hand on your back, I want you to palpate and extend laterally, and then you should feel this bump right here. A lot of times we refer to this as the tip of the shoulder. This is where this acromion is going to articulate or attach to the clavicle, so your collarbone. So the clavicle is going to be more anterior, the acromion will be more posterior, they meet up at the tip of the shoulder. So if you think about lifting the tip of your shoulder, that's that acromioclavicular joint. So very, not actually considered the shoulder joint, but very closely associated with the movements of the shoulder joint. Okay, so let's look at an anterior view now. And you can see this acromion extending a little bit superiorly, so you can still see acromion on in an anterior view. One projection I want you to note is the coracoid process. So for individuals that are quite thin, you can palpate the coracoid process, but it's an important muscle attachment site. You'll have your coracobrachialis attaching there, but also importantly your pectoralis minor. So pectoralis minor is deep and smaller than your pectoralis major and will play a role in terms of movement of the scapula. Now look at this portion right here. We know we're looking laterally now. This is referred to as your glenoid fossa. Sometimes you hear it referred to as glenoid cavity. And this is where the head of the humerus is going to attach or articulate. Now I really like talking about this area. When you're talking about a ball and socket joint, which is what the shoulder joint is, you have the head of a bone fitting into the socket of another bone. This is the socket of the shoulder joint. And what I want you to note here is how shallow this is. That humeral head does not fit well here, allowing for a bit more mobility in the shoulder joint than, say, you have in terms of your hip joint. So the very shallow glenoid cavity will allow for a higher range of motion, but also, on the other hand, it's less stable because you don't have as good fit between the bones. Okay, moving back more into anatomical position, the other area that I want you to understand is this medial border. So we know glenoid fossa is always lateral. This thin border right here is referred to as the medial border. You're going to have three muscles that are going to attach in this area. You're going to have the rhomboid minor, which is about at the level of your spine. So the rhomboid minor is right here. Rhomboid major is going to be inferior to that. And your levator scapulae is going to attach right here in what's referred to as the superior angle of the scapula. So putting this back in anatomical position, you can see that the body, or the majority of the scapula, is actually quite thin with this complex portion in terms of projections.